Samantha Spinner.
Listening Library presents Samantha Spinner and the Perplexing Pants by Russell Ginns. Read for you by Kathleen McInerney with Grover Gardner and including bonus audio puzzles created and presented by the author at the end of this audiobook.
The Thinker. A bronze statue of a man sitting on a rock with his chin resting in one hand is known around the world as the Thinker. French sculptor Auguste Rodin created his original plaster model in 1881, and he made dozens of bronze versions in many sizes over the rest of his career. The largest ones are more than 6 feet tall. Like Leonardo da Vinci's Mona Lisa and Michelangelo's David, Rodin's The Thinker is one of the world's most famous works of art. Pictures of the sculpture are often used to represent ideas, inventions, and learning. Today, 28 giant bronze thinkers sit in deep thought on steps of museums, in university courtyards, and at the entrances to buildings and parks in cities around the world.
The 28 largest thinkers sit atop entrances to super-secret tunnels around the world. When you are at the Detroit Institute of Art, take a closer look at the stone base beneath the statue. Find the side that faces the museum. Grab a corner and pull. The heavy panel will swing outward and reveal a staircase. The steps are covered with fine dust and can be slippery, so be sure to use the handrail as you enter. Also, watch out for the snow. Chapter 1. The Bad News Blares.
144! 144!
Sitting on the steps to his uncle's apartment over the garage, Nipper had thought he was far enough away from Sammy the parrot to not hear it screeching.
The Yankees are the worst! 144!
He wasn't. Somewhere behind his neighbor's house, Missy Snodgrass's double-triple super-awful pet bird squawked and blabbed. Nipper's Yankees were in big trouble, and the parrot made sure he knew it.
Did you hear that?
Said Mr. Spinner.
144!
Nipper turned to see his dad. He stood a few feet away, smiling and waving a yellow mitten-covered hand. In his other hand, he was holding up a fresh, steaming waffle with a pair of tongs.
That's a gross, son, said Mr. Spinner. Remember?
Yeah, Dad, I remember, said Nipper. A dozen dozens is one gross. That rotten bird is squawking about a gross of games.
Ever since Missy had stolen his baseball team, the Yankees had been on an endless losing streak. It was a major league catastrophe.
Cheer up, son,
said his dad, waving the waffle tongs in front of him.
I've made you breakfast.
Nipper caught a whiff of the fresh waffle. It smelled delicious. The aroma was soothing. He would love a waffle. He would have one, maybe two, maybe three. Waffles. Three. Nipper snapped out of it. Three more games. His Yankees only had 3 games left. He looked over to the Snodgrass yard. He squinted and tried to spot Sammy the parrot. He kept looking until his gaze fell on the back of the Snodgrass house. Nipper watched a green dot flickering on the covered porch.
Come back inside with me, said Mr. Spinner. When waffles get cold, the flavor decreases.
Nipper turned back to face his dad. In the 4 months since Mr. Spinner had taken over as the family's official breakfast maker, he had become a breakfast perfectionist. Nipper's dad applied science and math to waffle making. Normally, that was awesome. But today, it was just a distraction.
I'll be there in a minute,
Nipper said. He watched his father walk back across the pavement and disappear into the kitchen. Then he looked again toward his neighbor's house.
A gross of games, he repeated.
Nipper felt like he was caught in a gross game. The New York Yankees had just lost their 144th game in a row. If they lost three more times, they'd be finished. Gone. No more. According to Rule 1313, Section 13, any baseball team that loses 147 games in a season gets kicked out of the league. Their bats are chopped into firewood, and their uniforms donated to community musical theater groups. He couldn't let it happen. Not musical theater. Not his Yankees. His precious, super awesome Yankees. Nipper eyed the paper bag in his hand. He had been carrying it with him ever since he and his sister had escaped from the clandestine League of Unstoppable Daredevils, a band of skateboarders, surfers, and gymnasts, also known as the Cloud. He uncurled the top and peeked inside. Good. The special thing inside the bag was still there. He was going to need it, if he was going to save his team. Chapter 2. Morning, warming, warning. Samantha's eyes snapped open.
Where's Uncle Paul?
She shouted. She looked around. She was in her room, alone. She sniffed. The scent of fresh baked waffles filled the air.
Had Uncle Paul made breakfast?
No, it was her father downstairs in the kitchen. Of course it wasn't her uncle. Uncle Paul was missing. Again. A little over a week ago, Samantha had found her uncle. She'd had to defeat ninjas, clowns, and daredevils to do it. Then, when she hadn't been around, the moment she'd turned her back, Uncle Paul had gotten taken. Again. It was Nipper's fault, and her father's fault, too. She'd literally just gone upstairs, and a bunch of men and women in white coats and bright white sneakers had showed up at the house, and Nipper and her father had let them take her uncle away. Again! Nipper had said they were the math police, but Uncle Paul had left behind an old worn mitten and a note that said, "Watch out for the snow." Samantha didn't know much more than that. The only thing she had learned from what had happened was that her brother and her father weren't much help at all, especially when it came to not losing Uncle Paul. She sat up in bed and wiped sweat from her forehead. Why was it so hot in the house? She took in her surroundings. Her red umbrella rested against the side of her desk. She hadn't touched it for a week, not since her embarrassing fainting spell. Samantha had blacked out right after Uncle Paul had been taken away. The doctor said it was due to travel stress, plus a severe attack of coulrophobia, a fear of clowns. Samantha thought that was a bunch of hooey. She loved to travel. She had also defeated a band of awful clowns known as the Society of Universal Nonsense. That proved, beyond the shadow of a doubt, that she wasn't afraid of clowns. Samantha's mother said her blackout could also have been caused by the shock of seeing Buffy in a photo with a cute new boyfriend. And it was true that Samantha had been shocked. Her sister was completely awful. It didn't make sense that the boy who had saved Samantha and Nipper in Africa had suddenly shown up in California. And it made even less sense that he was there with Buffy. But what did her mother know about those things anyway? Dr. Spinner was a doctor, but all her patients were rodents and lizards. It didn't matter. Samantha had slept, rested, and thought about missing uncles, annoying brothers, unhelpful fathers, and ridiculous, selfish older sisters for a solid week. It was time to make new plans, and time to find Uncle Paul once and for all. But that was hard to do when it was so hot in the house. She got up and went to the window. She pulled it open, and a cool, fresh Seattle summertime breeze wafted into her room. Much better. Samantha saw her brother in the backyard, making his way to the house. They hadn't spoken much to each other in the past 7 days. At first, it was because Samantha had fainted and stayed in bed for a day and a half. Then it was because he wouldn't apologize for letting the people in white coats take Uncle Paul away.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.